just ahead on American Black Journal, I'm going to talk with an African-American trailblazer in Michigan's transportation department. She's the first black woman to hold her position. Plus, we'll tell you about two major projects looking back at Detroit's 1967 rebellion. Don't go away. American Black Journal starts now.
At DTE Energy, we believe that we have a greater responsibility. We believe that being part of a community means being involved in the fabric of that community, investing time, effort, and resources in the communities we serve. DTE Energy Foundation is a proud sponsor of American Black Journal.
Welcome to American Black Journal. I'm Stephen Henderson. March is Women's History Month, and my first guest is indeed a history maker. Kimberly Avery has made her way to the top of an industry that's traditionally dominated by white males. She's the first African-American woman appointed to the position of Southwest Region Engineer at the Michigan Department of Transportation. In that role, she oversees 1,200 miles of state trunk line, 280 employees, a $100 million capital program, and a $34 million annual maintenance budget. Later this month, she's going to be honored in Washington, D.C. by the Conference of Minority Transportation Officials. I'm pleased to welcome Kimberly Avery to American Black Journal.
Thank you.
Welcome to the show. So for nerds like me, I know what that means, that you're the Southwest Region Engineer for the Department of Transportation. But I think some people watching might not quite understand how big a deal that is. This is a significant amount of responsibility for, as I said, trunk line here in the state of Michigan.
Yeah, the being a region engineer, the Michigan Department of Transportation has seven regions. So this is one of seven, and so I report directly to the director of MDOT, and I'm responsible for seven counties, and we do everything from maintenance, construction, traffic and safety, design, so basically take care of that roadway system.
Yeah, and when we say trunk line, explain what that means.
That means all of the roadway that's owned by the state of Michigan.
Yeah, so for instance?
In my area, I'm in charge of I-94, I-69, in charge of like 131 in the Kalamazoo area in Battle Creek, and Albion, and all the way to the Indiana border.
Yeah, yeah, and talk to me about how you got interested in this. As I said in the open, this is a field that's dominated by males, first of all, but also by white males. What made you sort of say, this is what I want to do?
I think as a child, I was really interested in just basically seeing how things work. And so at the time, I think my mom kind of called it, you know, being kind of a little destructive. You know, I would take stuff apart, try to put it back together. A lot of times it didn't quite go back together correctly, but I learned something in the process.
Right.
And so as I, you know, grew and stuff and went through high school, I started to learn about engineering. And coming from, you know, Michigan, from being in Southeast Michigan, you know, the car industry was really big. Mm-hmm. And so I started to learn about what mechanical engineers do. And so I decided that, you know, I wanted to be an engineer. And so I went off to school, and then once I was in school, I kind of honed it down to I really wanted to go more into civil versus in the mechanical area.
Yeah, yeah. And talk about how you came to the Michigan Department of Transportation. How long have you been there?
I've been with the Michigan Department of Transportation for 26 years. Mm-hmm. I started off as a engineering in training, working in the Lansing area in construction, building highways in throughout the Lansing area, working out directly in the field with my hard hat boots, you know, sometimes, you know, with the flag in my hand.
And talk about that experience. I mean, again, you would have been one of the few women out there, I would imagine, on the side of the road with the flag and the hard hat, and of course, one of the few African-Americans doing it.
Yeah. You know, I think the biggest thing there was, you know, for me was really having a passion for what I did. and really not letting anything stop me, you know, when there were obstacles, especially working in the construction part of it. You know, a lot of times there were obstacles where they said, okay, you know, we're not sure if you can do this or that. You know, I took on the challenge and I said, you know, let me at least try.
Let me try it, right? And, How do you know I can't do it?
Right. And I found that I could do a lot of those things. And, you know, and the biggest thing was, you know, gaining the respect of the people that I worked with.
Yeah. And so from there, you get to this position of region engineer, obviously by performing well, but again, I would imagine that there were some obstacles you had to sort of navigate around on the way, right?
Yeah. So yeah, with anything there, there's those obstacles, and you know, and a lot of it is just, you know, taking it step by step, you know, setting some goals for yourself and figuring out how do you achieve those goals, and really making sure that along the way, you know, I was really you know, doing the best that I could to move from step to step.
Yeah.
And, you know, a lot of times, you know, raising my hand and volunteering for things really helped a lot with the things that I was looking
to do. And that's one of the things that I think when you talk, especially with young people, about how you get ahead and how you make progress, raising your hand and sort of asserting yourself is one of the things that you want to remember to tell them, because I think in a lot of cases, African-American kids in particular, because it's sometimes uncomfortable to be the only person like you in a situation, the natural instinct sometimes is to be quieter and not necessarily push yourself out there. You sort of have to push back against that instinct sometimes.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I found, you know, that a lot of times, I mean, because naturally for me, I'm more of a quiet person. And so I, you know, really had to get out of my comfort zone and really, you know, put myself out there and really show that I had the skills and abilities to do the job. And, you know, a lot of that is taking those chances and really getting out there.
Yeah. Do you see, when you look sort of down the ranks in the department, do you see more women and more African-Americans sort of coming through the pipeline now to try to take some of the opportunities that you had?
That's one of the things that the Conference of Minority Transportation Officials is working on, uh-huh. is really creating that pipeline of other African-Americans coming into the field. And we're finding that we are having problems finding people going into the transportation and engineering field in general. And so we're really trying to get the word out, sending, you know, professionals out to the schools, doing a lot of outreach to really, you know, show students that, you know, think about, you know, being an engineer, think about, you know, transportation as a career. Because I think a lot of it is just not getting the word out so that people know that that's an opportunity for them.
Do you feel like part of the problem is people who become engineers and don't want to become transportation engineers? Or is it, do we have a bigger problem with African Americans just becoming engineers in the first place? Or is it both?
I think it's a little bit of both.
Yeah.
I think, you know, the fear of sometimes being an engineer, because a lot of times when people say, oh, you're an engineer, they think that, okay, well, I'm not, you know, the big brainiac, so I can't really do that. And so I think that really taking that fear away from that, because one of the things that I do when I go out to and talk to students, I talk a lot about, you know, that you can attain this. You know, you just take it step by step. And then the other thing is, I think transportation is one of those fields that people don't know a lot about.
Yeah.
Because it's one of those things that we all use it, we all need it, but it's...
We don't know about it until it doesn't work.
That's right.
And of course, speaking of that, I would be remiss if I had you here and didn't ask you about the state of our roads here in Michigan. Of course, nationally, we rank very, very poorly, and anyone who drives the roads can tell you we have real challenges. The department gets a lot of blame for that. Of course, you're not to blame. You don't set the funding. You just have to spend the money. Talk about how you see that sort of getting better. We are going to spend a little more money on roads. Are people going to stop, you know, losing their feelings driving down 94 sometime soon?
I think it's going to, you know, it's still going to take time, you know, because we just got the new funding, and so it's going to take time to have that roll out and for people to really see that real change. But I think that the more that you know, we continue to do the make smart decisions as to what roads do we do, you know, how do we, you know, do a mix of fixes. What we do is we look at, okay, you know, keeping the good roads good and then also working on the existing system that we have. And so I think the more that we continue to do those things and make those smart decisions, people will see a change.
Well, congratulations on all your success and the award, the recognition you're going to get in Washington, D.C. And thanks for being here on American Black Journal.
Thank you so much.
All right, coming up next on American Black Journal, we're going to hear about two projects that focus on a big part of Detroit history, the 1967 uprising. But first, here's a look at some other important moments in Detroit's black history.
I'm Ken Coleman with a look back at African-American life in Detroit. This week in 1958, Della Reese delivered a lights-out performance at the Flame Show Bar. And in 1965, It's Growing by The Temptations was released on Motown Records.
My love for you just grows and grows. Oh, how it grows and grows. And where it's gonna stop, I'm sure nobody knows.
And in 1970, black students at the University of Michigan held a protest calling for increased minority enrollment and more financial aid. These are significant events this week in Detroit's black history, taken from the book On This Day, African American Life in Detroit.
A new year-long project will take a look at the social and economic conditions that led to Detroit's 1967 rebellion and explore whether these same issues persist in the city today. The Detroit Journalism Cooperative and Detroit Public Television's One Detroit will trace the city's progress over the last 50 years. In addition to Detroit Public Television, the DJC partners are WDET Radio, Bridge Magazine, Michigan Radio, and New Michigan Media. The group will focus on issues like power, political power, police and community relations, and poverty.
Forty-nine years ago on this spot, race relations in the city of Detroit erupted and shook the city's foundation forever. After a raid on a bar called a Blind Pig in this oldest and poorest part of town, crowds began to gather, and by mid-morning on July 22, 1967, the uprising escalated. 12th Street has been renamed and the landscape is different, but what have we learned from it?
We said it couldn't happen, but it did, and the nation was shocked.
The summer of 1967 saw dozens of uprisings in urban centers across the nation. Detroit's was the worst.
I do hereby officially request the immediate deployment of federal troops into Michigan to assist state and local authorities in reestablishing law and order in the city of Detroit.
43 people were killed, most of them black. More than 1,000 other people were injured. 2,500 stores were looted or burned. Nearly 400 families lost their homes.
It was just a burst of fire from the top of a building.
Before the fires in Detroit were out, President Lyndon Johnson appointed an 11-member Special Advisory Commission on Civil Disorder, known as the Kerner Commission. That commission ultimately blamed the violent outbreaks on federal and state governments ignoring the plight of black residents, on white attitudes toward blacks, and on mainstream media for ignoring the problems and consistently presenting only the white point of view. The report's most quoted conclusion read, "Our nation is moving toward two societies, one black, one white, separate and unequal."
This is a battle zone. These are troops. It's like war.
Nearly five decades later, the Kerner Report is still considered one of the most insightful documents on race relations and remedies for discrimination to ever be published by the government. It became a best-selling paperback, yet it was largely ignored by President Johnson and Congress. By some measures, black residents in Detroit are in worse shape now than black residents were during the civil rights struggles in the 1960s. Nathaniel Jones served as an assistant counsel on the commission and believes the Kerner Report remains an important way forward.
The answers are found in that document, and I think we need to focus as much as we can people's attention on what the findings of that commission were, what the conditions were at the time it was organized and created, and the recommendations that it came up with.
Over the next year, the Detroit Journalism Cooperative and Detroit Public Television's One Detroit will take a look at the grievances of Black America. We'll take a look at the hard numbers that tell us how life has changed for people of color since the Civil Rights Movement of the 1960s.
American Black Journal will bring you stories throughout the year on the findings of the Detroit Journalism Cooperative. Meanwhile, the Detroit Historical Society is also launching a project next year that looks back at 1967 Detroit. It's going to include a collection of written, audio, and video histories reflecting on that summer of civil unrest. And joining me now is the director of the Historical Society's Detroit 1967 project, Marlo Stoudemire. Welcome to American Black Journal.
Thank you for having me, Stephen. Yeah. It's great to be here.
No, it's great to see you. So one of the sort of questions that gets raised in the video we just saw is, how different are the conditions that exist now in Detroit from the conditions that led to the 1967 uprising? And I feel like there's a question we ask sort of off and on a lot around here. Obviously, it'll get more focus next year with the anniversary. But talk a little about what you see as similarities and differences.
Well, first of all, I think that that's a great point. It's all about perspective. It depends on who you ask and where people are in their Detroit experience.
Yeah.
So some people will look at the momentum that we're experiencing in downtown and midtown and say, wow, things have really progressed.
We're done. We fixed it.
And to a degree, that is a success. Yeah. Then others will point to conditions that not only exist in Detroit, but parallel some of the things that are happening across America. And it depends on where you are. It could be from a cultural perspective. It could be generational. It could be geographical. I would say that there's some advancements that we've made in areas of things like race relations, yeah, depending on what generation you're looking at. But then there's some things where we probably still have to do some work. Our job at the Detroit Historical Society is to really tell the stories and bring a face to them and make sure that people understand why they matter. And so we're speaking to different audiences. If you ask me as a native Detroiter and someone who lives still in the city,
yeah,
I would say we still have some work to do.
Yeah.
I would say that there are four key areas right now that we need to focus on, and that's economic inclusion and opportunity, race relations, youth engagement and development of their leadership, and advancement of neighborhoods, which all, depending on where you're looking at it from, are a little lagging behind.
Yeah, no, those are our areas of, depending on how you look at it, opportunity or challenge.
Right.
10 years ago when we talked about the 40th anniversary of the riots, I remember a conversation I had with Kwame Kilpatrick, who was the mayor at that time. He and I are the same age, grew up in the same time here in the city. And we were talking about the riots in the context of our kids and what the riots meant to them. Both he and I were born right after the riots happened and can remember it framing a lot of our childhood. But he said he felt like the riots weren't part of his kids' Detroit. They didn't frame the Detroit that they knew. And I always thought that was a really interesting way to see it, that for kids now, what does it mean? Now, we could argue about whether it frames people's reality or not. It does frame a lot of people's reality, but there still is that idea of distance, right, in time from something so horrific that eventually maybe we do get to a place where it's not the defining characteristic or moment for people here in Detroit.
Yeah, I think that first and foremost, I have a lot of respect for Kwame as an individual, regardless of the choices that he made
and
where he is now. I would say that, you know, part of what he's saying is true, but I also disagree to a certain extent. It all depends on the environment that you're growing up in and the people who make it relevant to you.
Yeah.
For example, me growing up, my mother and people in my family always shared the stories, always connected me to it.
You heard about it all the time.
You hear about it all the time, so it does feel relevant. But, you know, our generation, we're the generation after. We inherited a city that some feel was broken, whether it be disinvestment, whether it be lack of opportunity, you name it. We're the generation who inherited that, right? And so now what you're seeing is the seeds that were basically sowed years ago in the 80s and the 70s that are now coming up and blossoming into whether it be some beautiful and some weeds, right? So with that being said, I would say that the generation that's coming up now, needs that perspective, yeah. But it needs to be translated in a way that they can consume it, right? It can't be your traditional approach where you're gonna say, oh, back in our day, this is how we had it, you should feel lucky. You know, I even read something the other day where a young man posted on social media that said, you know, Stephen A. Smith said, oh, these kids don't know anything about racism. Racism doesn't exist for them. That's not true.
That's not true.
It comes in different forms and approaches it and has different manifestations of how it's presented, right? And I think that the key is, and this is why we're doing this project, past, present, and future generations, we have common threads. Yeah. It's the shared history. It's that collective history. So explaining why it matters, even for new Detroiters or people who decided to stay, it's about how we present it so they understand why it matters.
Well, and being able to connect them, right?
Right.
Being able to connect the experience of somebody who says, this doesn't really mean anything to me, to someone who can sort of say, well, this means a lot to me, and
right.
it really does still define the world that I live in. And I think if you go into a lot of neighborhoods in Detroit, there's no way to see it other than that, the riots or the uprising or whatever you want to call it, really changed the fortunes of that neighborhood.
So the point that you're making here is really one of the key points of our value proposition at the Detroit Historical Society. So a lot of people believe that those 5 days changed everything.
Yeah.
And we're saying, no, that's not true.
It was going.
Right? So we're going back 50 years, even prior to 67, yeah. to show how there was a groundswell that led up to those 5 days in terms of conditions, right? Then telling the story about what happened during those 5 days and offering people to have perspectives that are gonna differ.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean that there aren't multiple truths. There's no one source of truth. And then what happened after? And then more than anything, what are we gonna do to move forward to 2067?
Why? I mean, I think the question is always why. Your point that lots of people point to the riot or the uprising as the reason.
Right.
It's a symptom of something that was going on for a really long time in terms of the disinvestment in the city, the abandonment of the city. Talk about when people will start to engage. I know you guys are doing lots of interviews and things. When will we kick off this event in a way that people are starting to really see the events and the opportunities for them to get involved?
Right. So the project is a multi-year community engagement project. It features diverse voices, programs, and exhibitions that really helps us understand our collective history, you know, where we are now, how we got there, and then where we're going, right? With that being said, we're convening over 100 community partners, organizations, and individuals to help us really get the word out, number one, but also engage in conversations around those critical imperatives around discussions around race, making it a regional story, talking about the conditions, talking about the symptoms, and really kind of trying to bring everybody together. What we're saying is we're creating a model, and what the model literally is bringing a diverse community together around the effects of a historic crisis in order for people to find their role in the present to inspire the future. So what we do today matters more than anything. We can learn from the past, we can look ahead to the future, but the utility of that and the relevance of these tools, right, and how it parallels with what's going on in the rest of America and the world is important. So what you'll start to see is probably after we make our public announcement to the business community in Mackinac this June, is we'll unveil it to the business community and then we'll open it up in the summer doing a one-year countdown with programming, engagement, full marketing plans. By the time we get to 2017, when the exhibition opens and the actual anniversary kicks in, we're talking about renewal and moving forward. So we're not gonna glaze over the hard facts, but at the same time, this is all about moving Detroit forward.
So I'm curious what kind of potential pushback you're getting. What do you say to people who say, this was 50 years ago, I don't want to keep talking about this. I think we should move on. That's something that I hear a lot when you talk about race, when you talk about economics, when you talk about history. What's your answer to those people?
I would say pay attention. Pay attention to Flint.
Yeah.
Pay attention to Baltimore. Pay attention to Ferguson. Pay attention to the election, right? If we're going to move ahead as a region, it's not going to be separated. It's not going to be through finger pointing, but we have to understand the parallels of 67, a post-bankruptcy Detroit, and having a vision for where we're going in 2067. Those youth that you talked about who can't connect to it, we need to help them connect to it, because guess what? It won't be us leading us to 2067. It'll be them. right? And so it has to matter. It matters to everyone. What we're not going to do is we're not going to put you in a box and tell you how it should matter to you. We're going to present the information, right? That's number one. And we're going to bring people together. I would say that if you're pushing back, that's actually a good thing, because we want diversity of experiences, expressions, and thought, right? Sure. And opinions, right? But the objective is to make you pay attention and keep our eyes on the prize. And you're right, nobody wants to stay stuck in 67. The name of the project is Looking Back to Move Forward. But you can't move forward, right? So if we don't understand our past, we're probably in the dark regarding our history and our future.
Yeah. All right, Marlo Stoudemire, thank you very much for being here on American Black Journal.
Appreciate it.
That's our program for today. Thanks for watching. You can get more information about our guests at AmericanBlackJournal.org. And as always, connect with us on Facebook and on Twitter. Plus, you can also hear our program on WDET 101.9 FM. We'll see you next time.